An Italian palace set in an English park, said Winston Churchill of Blenheim, his birthplace and memorial to the ancestor who inspired him, 18th century war hero John Churchill, the first Duke of Marlborough. The palace is inseparable from the lush grounds that flank it, and credit for the beauty of its setting goes to the landscape gardener, Capability Brown. Since 1950, Blenheim, home to the present Duke, has been open to the public, and the need for visitors is as great today as it was then. Blenheim is about to enjoy its busiest weekend of the year. 4,000 people have entered a triathlon to be held in the grounds, and thousands more are expected to watch them. Several Blenheim staff will also be competing. Without events like the triathlon, it would be difficult for Blenheim to make ends meet.
There's always something cropping up at Blenheim which will be required to be done over and above what you already have to do with the general maintenance, painting, etc., the outside of the windows and plumbing, and etc. And there's constantly restoration work that has to be done.
We've now entered the first stateroom. Got four tapestries in the Blenheim series here on the walls. And look out for the Duke of Marlborough in all of them with his red jacket and baton.
Blenheim is something of a shrine to its original resident, the first Duke, John Churchill, a brilliant military strategist. He commissioned a series of tapestries chronicling his exploits in battle. For nearly a year and a half, one of the tapestries has been at Hampton Court undergoing delicate conservation work. But today, it's coming back to Blenheim.
It's been 14 months of restoration and conservation of the Boucher tapestry. As part of the conservation of the tapestries ongoing over the last sort of 10 to 15 years, we felt this was a priority to actually get this very large tapestry done.
There's a large proportion of silk within the tapestry, and this large area of silk is at the top of it rather than at the bottom. The bottom of the tapestry is predominantly made from wool. It's much stronger, but it's also heavier. So you have the heavier part of the tapestry hanging on the weaker part of the tapestries, and that's why it's degraded over time.
It's just amazing to see it come back in. It's like one of the sort of the children of the family have come back, so it's amazing. Can't wait to see it out.
It has to be handled very, very carefully because obviously it's quite old and it can damage further, so we're just very cautious. And we don't want to undo the work that we've just done. We've spent a long time conserving this tapestry, so we're very pleased to see the end of the work. And we hope that it all hangs nicely, and you never know until the last minute.
Visitors are surprised to see a scaffold tower in the sumptuous second stateroom. Getting the tapestry back up on the wall will be a tricky operation.
Everything's priceless, it can't be replaced. It's not, you know, you can't nip down to M&S and replace the sofas and things like that, so, yeah.
Doesn't give you sleepless nights, though?
No, we've been here for a little while now, and, you know, if you're careful and you've got your wits about you and know what you're doing, then, yeah, it should be fine, really. It should be okay.
In Blenheim's Great Hall, the expansive marble floor gives the team from the Royal School of Needlework room to work on their patient. The conservation project has taken longer than initially expected, and tens of thousands of pounds have been spent on this tapestry alone. With another nine tapestries in the series, all in need of some attention, the art of conservation is a costly business, but vital to ensure the tapestries will be hanging around for centuries to come.
It's really an exciting day. It's one of the biggest tapestries we have. And once it's up, I think they'll be a well-deserved lunch, but coming back and actually stretching the tapestry slightly so we actually get some of the bumps out of it. But it's looking absolutely fantastic.
It does fit exactly to the bottom, though.
It's incredibly heavy. So straight arm lifting, and at the distance is quite hard, but we're getting there. It looks like it fits, and even close up it looks really good. I'm very pleased with the work the girls have done. Nearly finished once I move the last lot of scaffolding.
Yeah, I'm going to turn. Yeah, that's okay.
Mind the feet.
Yeah, okay. Oh, we can't go any further.
Despite precious obstacles, the operation to rehang the tapestry has passed without incident, and most visitors would never know it's been away.
This is the Blenheim Bureau, made in the millennium, and it's a very fine piece, and on the roll top cover, the finest view in England as it's known, with the bridge, the lake and the palace. One wonders, in fact, if the Duke is very fond of this piece, because otherwise it would be in the private apartments, and instead it's on this side for you all to view. So draw your own conclusions from that. Through to the next room, please.
Before Capability Brown arrived on the scene, John Vanbrugh's Grand Bridge was more decorative than functional, spanning only a narrow canal. By building a dam to create a lake, Brown gave the bridge purpose. Despite financial temptation, the Duke is anxious not to spoil the view.
I would never have dreamt of having a safari park here at Blenheim, because I don't think it would be correct to have that in a Capability Brown park with the wonderful countryside that Blenheim. I'm not in any way criticising people who have safari parks. They've done extremely well.
Blenheim's parkland covers more than 2,000 acres. Historically, it was one of the oldest royal properties, a hunting forest with ancient oak trees and rich in game. These days, it's more about managing the land than farming it. The Duke, a farmer for many years, is as passionate about Blenheim's land as he is the palace, and is constantly exploring new ways to live up to Capability Brown's legacy.
I think this might be the ideal place to try a small avenue, Princeton Hill, because, as you know, that old barn, which is about to fall down, that's going to be taken down. And the idea is to build a new house on this site.
Yeah.
And I think if we can put an avenue here, it might be a nice entree into that area.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
You don't always think about it every morning that you're really lucky to be here. But there are certain occasions that you have to step back and think, actually, I've got a brilliant job here. It's absolutely fantastic. But please don't tell my boss.
I think I'm familiar with practically every acre of the estate. It's only by going around that you find out where there are problems or where things need to be done. In the olden days, I used to ride around a lot. I do a little riding now, but not nearly as much as I used to.
The Duke's got a phenomenal eye for detail, and some job that I'm thinking of doing next week, he always asked me to do today. Something that I haven't spotted, he always spots, and it keeps us on our toes, it does. Make sure you get all the nettles, because the Duke did call me yesterday.
Yeah, we're going to do park farm to
Estate. Right, OK, perfect, thanks.
One of the biggest events of the year at Blenheim is the triathlon, an event which capitalises on Capability Brown's landscape. The two-day competition will visibly transform the grounds of the palace.
The triathlon's a great event for me. I really love it. Because I do some triathlons myself, it's always been great to be involved with, and I've been involved since the very first one. It's brilliant to see it happening. It's just such an unusual sight to have a triathlon on as well, you know, with the transition area being in the great courtyard. And it's quite a complicated setup because the complete park is totally shut down for these few days that the triathlon's there, because every bit of it is used for swimming or cycling or running, so nobody can move anywhere. So trying to coordinate all that, make sure that all the residents know that they can't come out of their houses for certain times, and the gamekeepers can't move around at certain times. It's one of the most complicated events on the ground, I think.
Key to the event is the lake, where competitors start by swimming 750 metres. Several staff from Blenheim will be competing, and the Duke's given them a head start by allowing them to practice.
I'm here because I'm doing this triathlon for the second time. I want to just try and get in there and do a bit of practice before the event.
I've always fancied doing triathlons and always been a fitness fanatic and always been in the running clubs and stuff for several years. Having a triathlon on my doorstep at work, couldn't say no, really.
I came and watched last year, helped to marshal the course. It looked really good fun, even though the weather wasn't very good. And as I work at Blenheim now, I thought I've got to take part this year.
Well done, Kate.
It is freezing!
Paul Orsi competed in the last triathlon, but this year he'll be Blenheim's main point of contact for the event, liaising with the organisers who also staged the London triathlon.
The British Triathlon Association rules means that we have to test the water quite rigorously because we're going to have over 4,000 people swimming in the lake. Just the usual sort of water quality tests for E. coli and other sort of bacteria that may be found in the lake. We've never had anything. This is the third year of the Blenheim Triathlon, and so far all our water samples have come well and above EU standards for beaches and so on. So well above those standards, so there's never been a problem in the past, and we don't envisage anything now.
Tricky.
There's large pike have been found in this lake in the last couple of years. Big pike. Can't say it's a danger, but certainly the swimmers need to keep going swimming to make sure they don't get snapped by the pike.
No pike. Still got on my toes.
Gosh, that was really difficult. I thought it was going to be quite easy. I just thought it'd be like a normal swimming pool swim. But it's quite different.
That was brilliant. That was absolutely fantastic. It was absolutely amazing. And can't wait to do it. Can't wait.
Blenheim Palace is hosting a triathlon and hoping for a change in the weather.
We had 48 hours of rain over the weekend, which has really cut up the site badly. And it's also not really helped us in the car parks, which are all just cut up and muddy as well. So yeah, we're not having a good time at the moment. What will happen over the next sort of 48 hours will be another few marquees get built, a catering marquee. Sponsors will start coming in with their equipment. There'll be retail tents coming. And Once the triathlon starts, this is the main hub where people collect all their race information, their numbers. Then they'll head off down to the palace and get in the lake.
This is the third year of the event. We've had bad weather for both years so far. Last year it rained non-stop, so I think we're well prepared for it, but it does make it a challenge. It's just not pleasant to work in. Ideally, we'd all be in shorts and it would be a lovely, lovely weekend. But it's fine, and I think, to be honest, once the competitors are here, which is what we're here for, once they're here, they get on with it, and as long as they enjoy it, that's the key.
The problem is the grass here, and we've got 4,000 people expected to come in and go over the same area over 2 days, and this is going to turn into a quagmire.
It's already muddy, I mean.
Yeah,
this
so
is without anybody
down.
Standing on it.
Yeah, put the carpet down, and I think that'll do the trick.
Yeah, hopefully.
Yeah.
Because of the really bad weather, the triathlon people aren't able to set up their competitor village in the way that they would have liked. So they're trying to work out how they can set up their rival retailers so they don't fight. And everybody knew the plan, but it's completely changed now.
The Blenheim Triathlon is the biggest after the London event. It's Britain's fastest growing sport. Organisers are expecting 4,000 people to take part, but a lot depends on the weather.
It's incredible how much it's dried up. But if we do get rain, and it's still likely, I mean, it's Blenheim after all, so we've still got to get some carpet down. So we'll all head off, aim for, shall we just all check in, if the core team keep their radios? And
Blenheim's courtyard will be central to the event. The gravel was put down by the 10th Duke, the present Duke's father, who could not have foreseen that this will be the transition area, the place where competitors collect their bikes barefoot after the swim and return them before the run. The solution is to give the courtyard a makeover.
When the competitors come out of their swim, they run up to the great courtyard, and that's where they change into their biking gear to protect the floor, or protect their feet from the floor, which is gravel and cobbles. So we've put a carpet down.
through no one's fault, things happened and we didn't get the carpet we were going to, so we got some emergency carpet, and that's turned up, and we unfolded that, and that had all broken glass and wood chips and scarves and wine bottles and late-night debris left in it from the event that it was used at before. So we've had to clean that, so we've had people actually vacuuming that, so that's been interesting.
Have some people visiting today been bemused by the psychedelic carpet on the floor?
They have, especially by the hoovers. Being Blenheim Palace, we like to get everything perfect, so we've actually hoovered the carpet before we put the bike racks in.
Triathlon is Britain's fastest growing sport, and Blenheim lends itself effortlessly to the event. Temporary scaffold crossings are built in a day, and cattle grids are covered up. But is Blenheim an appropriate venue for a triathlon?
It's not something we would normally condone in the courtyard. Obviously, it just takes on a totally different look, and not one that we who work here or love the palace really like. However, it serves a purpose for the event, and we support it.
All of us that guide here at Blenheim, although we're guides and that's what we're employed for, we have enough commercial awareness to know that these things are required in order to run the palace here.
I don't really like to see advertising. It's a World Heritage site, and I, as a traditionalist, find it a bit disappointing that we have to have all these commercial events. But I understand the reason for it. It's necessary to pay for all the repairs that are continuous at Blenheim.
All this will be gone by Monday lunchtime, so there'll be no signage left. And it really does pull out quite quickly, and that's why we agreed to do these events. You know, they're very short build time and, short clear-up time. And that way we can, we don't disturb our visitors and the family any longer than we have to.
It's a misty morning at Blenheim, the first day of the triathlon. Last year, it rained on the palace's parade. But Blenheim's luck has changed. The sun comes out, followed by the visitors in their thousands.
I think this is probably the only triathlon in the world that takes place in a World Heritage site. So, it's special and unique, and things need to be special and unique, to create their mark. I think we've been very careful in how we've set out the events and the areas we've used, and I think, yes, it's potentially to the purist, shouldn't happen, but I think when you look at the success of it all around you, it's the second biggest event in the country. I think we've proven over 3 years that it's an event that justifies this sort of setting, and there's no finer backdrop than Blenheim Palace.
I think it attracts people because it is the palace, and the fact that you're not allowed to cycle around the park 365 days a year, so when they have actually opened it one day, gives everyone the opportunity to have a bit of blast round, traffic-free course.
The race control guys are pretty strict on the road closure, so we can't have anybody on the roads anywhere in the park, even the furthest extremities on their cycle route, so even our gamekeepers have to be shut out for the weekend, they have to find a different route in. Our residents almost get trapped into the park for 2 days, so it's hard work, but we seem to manage it, all right?
We've had 2 years of bad weather with this event, and now the sun's out, and you can just really notice it. There's just that many more people that come to watch, and there's a real buzz of anticipation. It's going to be
what
superb.
What a fabulous setting.
Yeah, it's just a joy.
The first wave of swimmers await the off.
OK, gentlemen, just had a call from the race control. It's all systems go, but there's no rushing. First wave, if you could slowly make your way forward to the pontoon. Have fun and good luck.
The next couple of days, wave after wave of swimmers, grouped according to age and sex, will take the plunge from this pontoon. Among them is Blenheim employee Nick. He's more of a runner than a swimmer, but like his colleagues Kate and Anita, he's been training hard.
Quite relaxed actually. I'm looking forward to try and enjoy the race and not get too anxious about how slow or fast I go. So it's a race for me to enjoy, so I don't feel too bad actually. I'm really excited and looking forward to it though.
The weather's absolutely glorious, as you can see, and everyone's out, all the families are out, and it's just a really good atmosphere here today. Being able to join in an event that is actually played out here is just marvellous.
It's out of the water at the Duke's boathouse, and Anita shows no signs of flagging.
That was good. I enjoyed that after all that.
Then it's a 400-metre uphill sprint to the palace, through the stable courtyard and into the transition area to grab their bikes. Next, it's cycling, two laps of Capability Brown's undulating park, over Vanbrugh's Grand Bridge, and onwards and upwards to Churchill's Victory Column. After the cycling comes the run. Elite triathletes waste no time in transition, cutting seconds where they can. But Nick's taking it all in his stride. He even finds time for a wave. Anita's pulled ahead of Kate in the cycling, making up for lost time in the swim.
Really enjoying it. Yeah, the bike was excellent. I loved every minute of it.
How was the swim?
Good. Really enjoyed it, actually. A lot better than I thought it was going to be.
And you're not even out of puff, are you?
I am a bit. I will be after the run.
You're looking forward to the run?
Yeah, I love the run. I can't wait for it, yeah.
Fantastic. Good
really
luck.
Excited. Thanks a lot.
See you on the run. Bye-bye. Bye.
The last stage of the triathlon is the run. Two laps of the lake. Nick crosses the finishing line, tired but happy.
Bike was all right until the chain came off. But it felt okay. Couldn't tell you how fast I did because the computer didn't work on the bike and struggled a bit on the run, to be honest. But pleased with that.
Anita looks like she could do it all over again.
It's good. And it's running around thinking, this is where I work. And it's really good. Really
what a sense of achievement.
Yeah, I do feel really great, actually, now that I've done it.
Kate had a strong swim, but would have preferred a cooler day.
Kate?
That was tough in the heat. Really tough. Anita passed me on, I think, the second lap of the bike. But really, really warm. Very tough, much tougher than last year.
It's been absolutely amazing. It's the best year we've had yet. Best turnout, fabulously organised, and everybody's having a great time.
I think there's scope for more and different types of event like this in the future because there's a huge demand for people to exercise, be athletic, whether it's a duathlon we do next or a cycling event. I think there's a huge desire, you know, to get out and about and enjoy, you know, England's fine country.
Next time on Blenheim. The Caravan Club celebrates its 100th anniversary, stuck in the mud. But the show goes on.
All the parents that have left their children in the marquee walk out and rescue your children because they're 500 foot.